this morning. And for those who are on Facebook, we appreciate you being part of this. We're going to go ahead and open up in prayer, and then Brother David will bring announcements. Brother Manuel, will you open us up in prayer this morning?
I
pride issue, but I don't think people from Texas are the only one that have pride issues. I think we all at times have pride issues. We take pride in our vehicles and our homes and all these other things. And so we have a pride issue where we think ours is better than everybody else, or bigger and better. And so Paul comes to really discuss with those Gentiles that he's been discussing over these last several chapters and the salvation of Israel, and building off what he talked about last week in Romans chapter 11, talking about how the Israelites' loss of Jesus, in other words, their rejection of Jesus, came in and God moved forward and brought salvation to the Gentile, and that gospel message this way. Well, now he builds on that again, telling him that don't take pride in that. Don't take pride in the fact that the Israelites were rejected because of unbelief, and yet you were accepted because of belief. And so he wants them to look at that, because oftentimes in church we have pride. We have pride in our own life, pride about our buildings, but we don't need to have pride. If we're going to have pride in anything, we should have pride in Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And so our text is out of Romans chapter 11, in verses 17 through 24, and if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
It says that some of the branches be broken off. And thou, being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree. Boast not against the branches, but thou boast. Thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. The apple say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spare not the natural branches, take heed, lest he also spare not thee. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on him which fell severity, but toward thee goodness. If thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shall be cut off. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. Or, if thou were cut off of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these, which be natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? Let's pray. Father, we come before you. God, we seek you. We seek your truth. We pray, Father, that you would touch our hearts today. That God, it be your message heard this morning. That God, we're not going to be prideful. But God, let us take pride in the one who saved us. God, let us be humbled by our salvation. Let us be humbled by the one who saved us. God, let us realize that you didn't leave Israel. Israel rejected you, Father, but if they'll come back to you, if they'll repent of their unbelief, you can still save them. So God, we seek you this morning. And we seek the salvation of our brothers and sisters, our family members. God, speak to us. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. He begins to talk to them about this new position that they have in Christ in verse 17. This new position that they have in Christ in verse 17. It says, if some of the branches be broken off, and thou being a wild olive tree, were grafted in among them, which pertains to the root and the fatness of the olive tree. He had been talking to them about how they have this new relationship in Christ. And now he begins to talk about these branches and how they were engrafted in, which was by nature itself, against nature. You wouldn't take something that was wild and put it into this tree and expect it to grow. This was against nature in and of itself, according to verse 24, which says that you were grafted in contrary to nature. And yet it lets us know that because of Israel's disbelief and God moving forward and extending his salvation to you, now you've been grafted in. Israel was broken off due to their unbelief. If some of the branches be broken off. And brothers and sisters, we need to understand this morning that Israel weren't broke off because they weren't God's people. They weren't God's people. They didn't lose a relationship with God because God didn't love them, because God did love them. God said they were the apple of his eye. But what hindered their relationship with God is the same thing that hinders our relationship with God today, which is unbelief. We
must believe. The Gentiles were grafted into the belief. In other words, they were made part of the tree of Israel spiritually because of their belief and acceptance of Jesus Christ. The only way that each of us will ever come to saving faith and knowledge in Jesus Christ is to believe. At one time, we were all separated due to our sins. Amen? We were all separated. We were dead in our trespasses and transgressions. We were no different than the unbelieving Israelite that God had broken off due to unbelief. In fact, Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus in 2 and 5, even when we were dead in sins, have quickened us together with Christ, by grace are ye saved. The third thing we find here is the Gentiles were made companions with Israel through Christ's word. The true Jew, the one that was not circumcised physically, but the one that was circumcised of the heart. That they truly became one in Christ. If you turn over into the book of Ephesians, and I'm just going by memory here, in Ephesians, Paul writes to them and it talks about that middle wall of partition being broke down. For many years, I preached about this in 9 o'clock. At many times, and for many years throughout my ministry, I preached that middle wall of partition was talking about the partition between us and God. But really, contextually, that's not what it's talking about in that text. If you go back and you look contextually where that text is, it was talking about the middle wall of partition between the Jew and the Gentile. And when Jesus Christ died on that cross, he joined both the Jew and the Gentile, those who had accepted Christ. He brought them together and brought them under one Savior, and that's Jesus Christ. So it is no longer the Jews over here and the church over here. We are one people in Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul is telling them today. He's saying, look, don't take pride over the unbelieving Jews. Don't take pride because you were just as they were. And but for the grace of God through Jesus Christ, you've been brought in. It says, with them partakest. In other words, you become a companion with the root, who is Jesus Christ, in the fatness of the blessings of that. The Gentiles truly have become joint heirs with Israel through the redemptive work of Christ. Even more than that, we as Christians have become joint heirs with Christ. And may we realize he, Jesus Christ, brought us into the fold of God when we were not part of God's chosen people. We weren't God's chosen people. But God chose us through his son, Jesus Christ. We were wild olive tree. We were people of our own. We were on our own fold. A fold opposite that of God's fold. John wrote in John chapter 10 and verse 16, Jesus speaking says, another sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also must I bring, and they shall hear my voice. And there shall be one fold and one shepherd. At the end of the day, brothers and sisters, there's not Israel, there's not the church, for one in Christ. And we must realize this, for one in Christ. And may we realize that we're not to be prideful about our salvation. Too many times we act like a frozen chosen in church. We snub our nose at a lost person in the synagogue. Well, I got Jesus and they don't, so they're just not as good as me. The reality of it is we're not better than anybody else. We've all sinned. We can take our stances, we can take our issues, but the reality of it is we're no better than anybody else without Jesus Christ. It's only in Jesus Christ that we are made part of the kingdom of God. It is not about self. Christ sustains us and not the other way around. It's the root that sustains us. And so we realize that there's a new position in Christ, but there's no room for pride in the economy of God. We're not to be arrogant and boastful, but we're to be loving and caring. We can call sin sin, but still be loving and caring. We can tell others they need Jesus, but be loving and caring. Because he says here there's no room for pride in verses 18 through 22. He begins with, don't let your pride get in the way. I don't know about you, but my pride has been gotten in the way several times. Amen? Dude, we got pride and it gets in the way. Just go there, amen, preacher? I mean, you know, we let our pride get in the way. We let our ego get in the way. We let it get in the way of ministry. We let it get in the way of ministry. We let it get in the way of our families. We let it get in the way of our relationships. We let it get in the way of way too many things. when we should be letting go of our pride. And if we're going to have pride, let it be in Jesus. But it says, boast not against the branches. In other words, don't look at those that are lost. Don't look at that lost Israel and go, ha! You guess what you gave up? I'm so much better than you because I accepted Jesus. Brothers and sisters, the world does not need religious hypocrisy. What they need is the love and forgiveness of God. It says, boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the fruit, but the fruit of thee. In other words, if you're going to boast, boast in the fact that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're going to boast, boast in the fact that Jesus changed you. If you're going to boast, boast in the fact that the Lord is part of your life now, that you're part of Him. Paul warned his readers not to brag about this status and rub it in the face of Israel. Paul warned his readers that it was Christ's fruit that bore them and not themselves. We can't make it on our own, brothers. We can't do it on our own. We can't make it on our own. We can't do anything on our own. It doesn't matter how long we've been going to church. It doesn't matter how much scripture we memorize. It doesn't matter how much money we put in the offering plate. None of that matters without first having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? Because that's what it's about. Paul warned his readers it was Christ the root that bore them and not themselves. We are to be reminded that Israel was not rejected to save us. Gee, God didn't look at Israel and say, you know what? Oh, yeah, I'm God with you. I'm going to find a Gentile because of, you know, I didn't have it today. He left Israel to come back later to him. But it was always in God's plan to bring salvation to us in the first place. He just didn't reject them to come save us. He saved us in spite of them to use us to bring them to Him. So don't let your pride fool you. Don't let your pride fool you. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, lest He also spare not thee. Or if God spared not the local, the natural branches, it says Israel was rejected due to unbelief. It says they were rejected due to unbelief because of the unbelief. They were broken off. But we are only able to continue because of faith, and thou standest by faith. Brothers and sisters, God is no respecter of person. My kids will try to tell you sometimes I have favorites. And they will all point to one of them in particular and say, well, we know who that is. And that one in particular even tell you, oh, I don't give you a favorite. Look, even if I had a favorite, I wouldn't tell you. And the reason I wouldn't tell you is because it changes weekly depending on the circumstances who my favorite is. But the reality of it is God has no favorites. David's over there. David, you understand this. You're dad. but the reality of it is God has no favorites. God is no respecter of persons. He says He causes it to rain on both the good and the bad. So it doesn't matter to Him. The reality of it is we need to realize something. If He rejected Israel because of unbelief, He will reject us too because of unbelief. Amen? And that should make us fearful. That should make us sit there and realize, look, if He judged His own people, He will judge us too. And so don't let your pride inflate your ego. Don't let your pride inflate your ego. Because many times that's where we fall. We get this pride. We get our ego build up. We get pride built up about our churches. We get pride built up about our ego. We get ego built. And we have all this idea. And we have all these things that we just fill our head and we take so much pride in. The reality of it is, if you're a child of God, you should still be in fear of God. We have this idea, well, God is love. God is, yes, God is love. At the core of God is love. In fact, the Bible says that God is love. And without God, you can't know what love is. But He's also a vengeful, wrathful, judging God. And if He's willing to allow His Son to die on the cross for our sins, then most definitively, He is going to judge sin. Amen? And He's going to judge unbelief. And so this idea that we can go and accept it, this is, no! Let us be fearful, church. In fact, says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. He tells us to be fearful, to work that out, because God still judges today. But we also love this fact. God is still able to save today. Just as God is going to judge, and just as God is going to address our pride and address our ego and address the fact that when we look down our stone-cold noses at people because they in sin and we're supposed to be a holier-than-thou righteous Christian, he says, don't do that because I can still save you. In verses 22 and through 24, it says, behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fail. Severity, God will judge the unbelieving. The severity of God on them which fell. In other words, God brought judgment. God cut the nation of Israel off, at least for a time being, because of unbelief. Because of them not choosing him, just as he does still today. But God is still also able to save. God is also still able to save, where it says, behold, therefore, the goodness. But toward thee, goodness. If thou continue in his goodness, if you'll continue in it. We have many people in the church today that like to play church. They like to play Christian. They have the Christian answers. They got the Christian facade. They got the Christian decorations. They got all the right answers. But deep down inside, they know for a fact they're lost. They're not rooted well in the Lord. Maybe they got a little faith, and they heard the scripture, and they like the idea about God, but they just don't know God. And he says the only way to truly be saved is to continue in that. And we don't continue in the Lord to be saved, we continue in the Lord because we're saved, because it's only through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit that we're even able to continue in the Lord. Amen? We can't continue on ourselves. Our natural man wants to run and rebel and everything else. I know this. Because I have a tendency to want to rebel. But I have to fight it every day. But he says that we are to continue in God. He says, behold, therefore, the goodness. But toward the goodness of God, continue in his goodness. And get this, if Israel turns from their unbelief, God will still save them because of his goodness. Just as he saved us, when we stop rebelling and we finally said, I believe. I believe. It says in verse 23, and they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again. In other words, God's not through with Israel. And if you're here this morning and you're still questioning about God and still questioning about faith, understand God's not through with you yet either. The fact that you're questioning it and you're battling with it shows that God is not through yet. But he tells us, do not take your position for granted. Otherwise, that shall also be cut off. He said, don't take that relationship for granted. He's not saying you can believe in salvation. I don't believe in the preservation of the saints. You're even believing. But don't think God will discipline you if you mess up. Don't think God will over a few things just to say, you know what? I met Paul said, I don't remember the guy's name, but he said, I handed them over to Satan so that their body might be destroyed, but their soul would be saved. Brothers and sisters, there's times in our life where God just takes his hand off of us. So don't take your position for granted. And God will use believing Israel just as he's used believing Gentiles. In verse 24, it says, for if thou were cut off of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature. He said, if you were brought in contrary to what God wanted, what nature really is, then how much were these, which are natural branches, grafted into their own olive tree? If they would just turn from their sin, and they'll disbelieve, God says, I'll save them too. And I'll close this morning with this. If you're
pray for those of us that are hurting this morning. Those of us that are just needing prayer. That we realize, Father God, you are there with us the whole time. God, we see you. We see the salvation of our lost friends and family, Lord, and yes, even our enemies. God, we thank you.